I believe that our yea should be yea and our nay should be nay. In other words, if this is the truth, then we need to proclaim it and we need to teach it. It's important and even profitable for us to realize that music was designed by God to serve a purpose. God says, no, don't do what you want to do, because usually that gets you in trouble. It's my will that will steer you carefully. Amen? Because we should say, nevertheless, not my will, Father, but yours be done. I'd like to welcome you to the fourth meeting of this seminar entitled The Distraction Dilemma. And this particular meeting is entitled The First Movement, Music History, 450 AD to 1969. So we're going to cover a lot of ground, hopefully in about an hour. The last message that we just went over, sometimes a little hard for people to palate that one, because we're starting to get into things that are starting to step on toes a little bit. And so I just want to assure you that this message will step on the rest of them. And then the next message will step on some fingers, and then the next one, before you know it, we'll just be stomping all over you. Now, the reality is this. I believe that our yea should be yea and our nay should be nay. In other words, if this is the truth, then we need to proclaim it and we need to teach it. We don't want to monkey around and just go, well, oh, I think. We're just going to present the information. You take it, you pray, and you ask the Holy Spirit to guide and lead you. Fair enough? Amen. All right. Before we move on and we dive into all these music samples, it's important and even profitable for us to realize that music was designed by God to serve a purpose. I don't know that God ever had indiscriminate listening in mind when he designed music. Message to Young People 291 declares, "The history of the songs of the Bible is full of suggestions as to the uses and benefits of music and song, rightly employed." So by implication, rightly employed. By implication, this means that it can be wrongly employed or incorrectly employed. Before we continue, let's have a quick word of prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, we ask that as we dive into this music message and we dive into this seminar, that you would give us wisdom. And may our ears be tuned, and may we hear godly music, and may we hear the difference in the worldly music. I pray that we would not be entertained by these samples, but rather educated. We ask for the Holy Spirit to guide and lead us now. In Jesus' name, amen. So when music is rightly employed, it can be a benefit. It's a precious gift of God, designed. So music is designed just as much as you and I are designed. It's designed to what? To uplift the thoughts to high and noble themes, and to inspire and elevate the soul. So with this in mind, music was designed by God to be a blessing. It's just been perverted over the years. Now, we're going to go way back to the Tower of Babel. We're going to go back to some of the earliest inhabitants of this earth, and they were at the Tower of Babel, and they were having some problems to where they believed that they could ascend into to the heavens, and they would be as gods, and all this stuff that was going on. And present at the Tower of Babel, we had those that worshiped the Creator God, and we had those who worshiped Baal, and they were engaged in pagan worship. And so we had pagan worship of Baal or the sun god before and after the flood. And when people scattered, they took with them pagan sun worship or the worship of the true Creator God. In fact, today, pagan worship remains in many forms and is still practiced. Now, let's advance from the Tower of Babel to about 450 AD. In the medieval times, the Middle Ages, this is when there was a beginning of a basic system of musical notation. And before that, it was largely not recorded. They would write songs, but it was more of the lyrical content. There wasn't a notation system in place yet. And this is also the beginning of polyphony. At this the instruments largely before this time, everything was either sung just melody alone or an instrument plucked with one string at a time. And polyphony simply means many, poly, many, phony with sound. They would play different sounds at the same time. And this was the birth of harmony. Music was an integral part of worship, both pagan and Christian. God wants us to have music in our worship. There's nothing wrong with that. But the devil also has music in his worship services. The troubadours appeared in about 1180. They were called the minnesingers, or singers about love. They primarily performed for nobility, and typically they're accompanied by stringed instruments. They sang about courtly love or chivalry, not, you know, oh baby, it's you and me. No, it was about ennobling and edifying the wonderful relationships that should exist between a man and a wife. And this would be typical of what you would have heard. So you can imagine this happening in a court of the king. They'd come in and play with a simple instrument, a melodic line, and they would sing along with it. Now let's jump to the Renaissance time, from about 1450 to 1600. And Renaissance actually means rebirth. And many changes in the way that music was created began to happen. Composers concerned themselves with three areas of music: sacred, secular, and instrumental. Now, here is a sacred piece from about this time. That nice. It's like, wow, are those angels? Now, hold on to your seats. This is a secular piece from the same time. Why are you giggling? That's secular music. Back in the 1450s to 1600s. So we have this beautiful thing that was happening in music. And you have to understand that largely music was actually an instrument of the church, largely speaking. There's always exceptions to this. And so what would happen is the church had the money to pay the musicians to make this their livelihood. And so they would learn these instruments, and that was their job, to perform perfectly, amazingly, with skill, these instruments and this beautiful music that was being arranged and composed. And what's interesting is it actually was to lift the listener to God. It served a purpose. And so even the secular music had the exact same body language. Amen? All similar in nature, and they shared smooth, gentle rhythms and melodies with balanced phrases. Now let's advance to the Baroque period. Baroque means bizarre. Musicians embraced the idea that music could move the listener in a real and physical way. They started to realize, wow, this can actually move people. And of course, the more that we add to the songs and to the music, it can move people just so fantastically. In fact, I'd like to play a piece for you, a secular piece, during this time. That's actually a secular piece of music by Vivaldi, The Four Seasons. I love this song. When that's played that well, that just amazes me. Now, in the same period of time, this is Handel's Messiah. Now, I want you to pay attention that how the music is affecting you. What's the message it's giving you? What's it sending to you? Does it make you want to, dance the night away with your loved one? Or are you being elevated and ennobled when you listen? And this, of course, during the time would be a sacred piece, Handel's Messiah. It makes you kind of want to go. Thank you. Now, that's music in Europe. There's not a lot of music known before this time because America hadn't been settled yet. Make sense? So, what we had before would be tribal music of the Native Americans, the Indians. And so, before about the 1600s, there wasn't any influence musically except for the natives. In 1640, this indicates the dominance of religious music in America during this time. In fact, this particular manuscript you see here is the Bay Psalm Book was printed. And this Bay Psalm Book is the first hymn book in British colonial America. And this is what you would have heard in America about this time. Still very traditional sounding. Classical era, from about 1750 to about 1800. A very short-lived time, but a tremendous amount of music was written during this time. The piano was the primary instrument used by composers, and music began to be seen as an innocent luxury now. It wasn't just relegated for the super rich or the kings and the queens. It was now being wonderfully promulgated and dispersed around the world. Francis Hopkinson was a signer of the Declaration of Independence. He helped design the American flag, and he is one of the first American composers. In 1759, he wrote, "My days have been so wondrous free." Now understand, this was an early secular clip, piece of music in America.
"Days have been so wondrous free, the little that fly with
simple, beautiful, yet secular." It was included in a collection of songs dedicated to his close friend, George Washington. Beethoven produces his third symphony, Eroica. There was a lot. Now we're back to Europe and we're enjoying more orchestral music. But even with the European influence upon the American music scene, it was still very traditional sounding, and it was indeed strongly influenced from Europe. Now the Romantic period, from about 1800 to 1900s. This period of time was characterized by using music to tell a story or express ideas. Now we're starting to unlock, wow, we can actually tell stories through music and give ideas into the listener's mind. And understand, this largely was non-lyrical based. But there were some, of course, different arias and things that were written for singers. Some big shifts were happening. Nature was seen in a less idealized way than before. It was less of a model of perfection and more of a source of mysterious powers. You see, it's important to understand that before this time, when we were writing music, largely all music was written in the classical eras to where it was ennobling and edifying. There were always exceptions to the rules, but largely it was. And so what happened is it would lift you, and it was actually the source of this music was to be God, or the gods, depending on where you came from, Greece or wherever you had come from. And so they believed, by and large, that revelation and inspiration came from God, and that God had created, and God created everything that we saw. And so they had all this inspiration around them to write these songs. And then it began to be seen less as a model of perfection and now a source of mystery, largely due to this man, Charles Darwin. What's interesting is it really began to change the thinking of humanity. And as a result, we could look around and look at nature now, and we're not thinking, look what God has created. It's like, oh, wow, how did that come to be? And all these questions. And so what's interesting is the music itself started to change and have that body language. Very, very powerful. Composers took an interest in philosophical ideas and in the music of various ethnic groups and began incorporating it into their own music. Just as in Europe, America was experiencing a shift in music as well. In the 1800s, slaves from Africa were sold to white merchants in North America. They brought with them from Africa their ritualistic religious practices known as voodoo, heavily wrapped around the tribal drums. So what happened was, when these African, what a blight on American history, but it is the reality, and so I can only share the reality. When the slaves were sold here to America, they brought with them, or wanted to bring with them, the pagan ritualistic ancestral worship that they had in their customary worship services, in their culture. And when the different owners of these slaves heard this music, they forbade the slaves to play their music. And so they took their tribal drums from them, they took their different percussive instruments away from them. And so what happened was, the slaves found a way to continue to keep their music alive. In fact, what's interesting is they kept these ancestral rhythms and the pagan worship rhythms alive through their feet. And the tap dance was actually invented. And so they were able to tap out these polyrhythmic elements and keep alive these rhythms. Very, very interesting how it all happened. And so we, since we live in America, and American music has been largely influenced by the slaves being sold into America, this is why we're going to talk about it. And so goes America, you've heard the term, so goes the world. So it started here, where we began to amalgamate some of our music with the slaves' music, and this whole new kind of music emerged. And we will show that in a couple moments. So we have to understand, though, that we're not down on the Africans, because the reality is that this tribal music happens all over the world. In fact, let's look at a world map here. And we could go to Latin America and hear the exact same tribal beats and rhythms. This is Latin America. So this is what we would call a polyrhythmic rhythm section. Okay? Let's move on. Let's go to Native America. Do you hear all the same kind of elements? Okay, let's go to Scotland. Okay, let's go to Russia. How about Japan? How about India? Sounds like a rock and roll rhythm, really. And then finally to Africa. So the reality is, it's not just an African thing, it's a worldwide thing. Are we clear? Okay. The fact of the matter is that this music is all over the world, and this music is actually in the pagan worship rituals. And so this ancestral worship, where they worship their dead ancestors and want to become possessed by different demons, which we'll get into in just a moment, was largely happening around the world and in Africa as well. Now, in the 1800s in America, the drums were not accepted by Protestants and the slaves were forbidden to use them. In Congo Square in 1817, in the heart of New Orleans, this became the gathering place for slaves. It is here that the ritual African music underwent a very interesting metamorphosis. Eventually, with the blessing of the Catholic Church, they were allowed to use this music, but slightly modified without resilience. So what is voodoo music? What is African ritual music? Well, John H. Steele, in his book, The World of the Unexplained, begins to teach us. The follower of voodoo seeks to incorporate Allah, or a lesser god, into himself by writhing and leaping through a dance while drums bang out complex rhythms. Okay, here is a key element. Complex rhythms. From here on out, I will call them complex rhythms, or I will call them polyrhythmic elements. And that means many things rhythmically happening at one time. Poly means many, okay? When just the right rhythm is found for an individual Lao, or demon as we would know it, the dancer takes it up and the demon enters his soul. The religion is strictly Dionysian. And one thing that you will always find in pagan worship, you will always find three things. You will find sex, mind-altering drugs, and hypnotic music. In fact, let me just throw this out to you. This is the chosen slogan for the rock and roll industry: sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Very interesting. Michael Venture, to tribal peoples, religious worship is seen as a bodily celebration. This is why the rhythm or the beat in their worship music is so accentuated. The goal of African religions is to experience with their bodies the crossroads of the physical and the spiritual worlds. Michael Hodges continues, each percussive or vocal part has a slightly different rhythm, which coincides with and sometimes crosses the other rhythms or the guiding pulse at strategic moments. The drummers often shuffle their feet or sway their bodies in dance-like motions to assist them in maintaining contact with the main beat, especially when the rhythm is what? Syncopated. So when we have all these different rhythmic elements happening, the fact that there's many layers of it and they're all doing different things on different times within the measures, what happens then is it becomes a problem for the frontal lobe. And so when the frontal lobe goes into this alpha pattern, the beta waves are gone. They are at the crossroads of the physical and the spiritual, as they call it, the crossroads. And we're going to hear about the crossroads coming up again. And so what happens now, we're open for demon possession, and the demon jumps in. They start writhing around. They get supernatural power. They have all these things that happen. And then the whole thing ends. This is all the worship service. The whole thing ends in inappropriate relations between men and women. Does that make sense? We have little ears in here, so I want to be careful. During these rituals that still take place in the Congo and Yorubaland, the intricate layers of the multiple rhythmic drumming are considered the primary source of occult power. We read earlier that when we think we don't need to be careful of what we allow into our thinking, into our ears, and what we look at and what we behold, we read earlier that when we think we don't need to do this during our musical choices, that we open ourselves up to evil angels and their possession. Do you remember that quote? Well, friends, the occult experts are telling us the same thing. It's the multi-polyrhythmic elements, especially when they're syncopated, that becomes the source of occult power. I don't want it! I don't care how it's labeled, how it's packaged. I don't care if they call it secular or Christian or whatever they want to. I don't want to even... What if just the fact that the potential is there, I don't want it. Amen? Whew. So now we're going to listen to some actual voodoo samples from old to modern. And we're going to have an extra prayer right now. Gracious Heavenly Father, as we listen to these samples, I pray that our ears would be educated and not entertained. In Jesus' name, we ask for your protection. Amen. So the whole point of these voodoo worship service, ritual worship, is to get to a trance so we can be possessed. But you have to understand that you have to be a willing participant. You have to want to be a part of that. For instance, drummers, you can see videotape, which, you know, is kind of scary, but you can see videotape on the internet of these actual things that still happen today. And you can see the drummers, and they're doing this whole thing, and this guy's over here getting fully possessed. He's a willing participant. And these over here seemingly aren't. It's interesting how that happens. Other times, the entire people, everybody around is involved, and they're in this occultic experience, and they're becoming possessed. So just the fact that the potential exists scares me. I don't want to play with it. In other words, I don't want to go on the devil's enchanted ground. Amen? So now we're going to listen to some voodoo clips. And these clips are going to start from very old. And I want you to listen to the rhythmic elements in it. Lots of layers of rhythms, okay? And then it's going to go all the way through to the modern day versions where it's still the same kind of music, but now they've taken it into the studio. They've added bass drums and different things like that to enhance the audible experience. Even the way the voice is being sung, that can be a rhythmic element in all of that. We're going to come back to this clip, by the way. This would be a basic backbeat rhythm. So the reality is, this is not new rock and roll. This is some of the oldest music on the planet. Hear the little shakers, little glass, ding, ding, ding. Polyrhythmic elements. It just sounds more tribal compared to what we listen to. That's pretty fast. Even the way da 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 da, it's very rhythmic. Little more modern now. It's been taken into a studio. A little fuller. Hear all the elements? Source of occult power right there. This is even more modern. Now we got a guitar in there, rhythm guitar. The whole thing is rhythm. Now listen to this. This will tell you a story.
In the beginning was the beat, and the beat was the rhythm of God, and the rhythm of God is the harmony of humanity, and where there is harmony, there is peace.
Now that's just today's sound right now. They're going to tell you a little story though, listen. Africa to America, we are the drums. So what I'm telling and sharing with you is common knowledge. This is how it happened. A voodoo priestess from Brazil. Ah, my brother here in the front might appreciate it. He's from Brazil. The rhythm is more important than the meaning of the words. Our gods respond to the rhythm among all else. So this is a worldwide phenomenon. Psychology Today says this. They've had an article, it's very powerful, back in actually 1985. Musical rhythms affect both our hearts and our brains. One road to arousing a range of agitated feelings, tense, excited, sometimes sexual, is through pronounced and insistent rhythms. Artfully used to heighten the sexual tension, drumming may produce these powerful effects by actually driving the brain's electrical rhythms. Like we talked about before, that it causes a friction in the hemispheres of the brain. It leads to nervous breakdowns, shakings, tremors, loss of concentration, and science has directly related exposure to syncopation and repetitive rhythms to each of these problems. It might seemingly make us feel good, but it attacks our physiology and our neurobiology. Michael Venture, the expert in all of these customs of different tribes around the world, he says, in the tribal ceremonies, there was no audience. Everyone became a participant. But in Congo Square, African music was put into a Western form of presentation. So now, you'll remember that it was after 1817 in Congo Square that the African ritual music underwent that interesting metamorphosis. Now, the religious African element, still present, became a secret within the music rather than the object of the music. So now, all the elements were still there, But in New Orleans, a port town, where there were people that were coming from around the world, heard this new music, and they were like, whoa, what is this? And they were allowed to play this music because they started to bring in some of the American thoughts and ideals and body language with their body language, and all of a sudden this new kind of music was starting to be born. Very, very fascinating. Because the visible elements of ritual worship were now hidden, a much wider audience could accept African music. In the 1840s, a lot of blacks started turning to Christ, praise the Lord, and they were allowed to have their own churches. Some turned away from drums completely. Others incorporated them into their new faith. They would sing the same hymns as the whites, but with shouting and beating out counter rhythms on tambourines, gourds, and logs, eventually bringing about the Holy Flesh movement. Congregants still sought for possession, but now it was called the Holy Ghost. Isn't that interesting? So we speak in tongues, we flip around on the floor, do all this kind of stuff, let our prefrontal cortex be short-circuited, we can become possessed by the Holy Spirit and have supernatural ability in the worship service. Wow. This was the birth of that Holy Flesh movement. In America, around 1875, Dwight Moody and Ira Sankey began to write a lot of different hymns. And this hymn you will recognize. It's just a little one that some people have heard before, Amazing Grace. And this would characterize what it would sound like in America at this time. Very traditional. So while there were these churches that were starting to be changed a little bit by this fun, different kind of African influence, there were other churches that were staying very traditional and saying, this, we don't see any good in it. We got to be very careful here. So there was this kind of dichotomy that was going on. And you have to understand that at first, the whites were like, I don't think so. But then they're like, tasting a little bit like, we kind of like this. Before you know it, the whites were right in there as well. So it wasn't a black-white thing, it was just a human thing. Amen? Now, in 1851, around this time, this would be a secular piece in America, and it would be acceptable. It's more of a folk sound. So it doesn't stir all this stuff within us. It still has a more of an ennobling and edifying effect. In 1859, around this time, and even before, Dixie music started to really take off. And this particular folk American music. Now, I want you to note, as we're listening to it, as we continue to start paying attention, we need to pay attention to how it might move our body. Typically, when you're playing classical pieces, like your head might kind of move around a little bit and do that. You might tap your toe, perhaps, or your hand may want to start going. Your upper torso, you know, maybe you want to start moving a little bit, and that's fine. And all of a sudden, when you start adding some different rhythmic elements, African rhythmic or any sort of pagan rhythmic element, all of a sudden, the lower part of our body wants to start moving. It's pretty interesting. This would be a sample of Dixie. Now you'll notice that the beat is prominently, dominantly on the 1 and 3, but there is another cross rhythm coming in too that's on the 2 and 4. It's very subtle, but the point of this clip is to show you how it started to happen. It wasn't just all of a sudden, boom, here's our music. Boom, here's what. It was an amalgamation over time. Dixieland, where I was born. It's dominantly 1 and 3, but there is a syncopated element in it. So traditional American music at this point had not adopted the lower bass sounds, if you will, of the tribal music. Yet it did have strong rhythm and syncopation at times. The big problem began when we started to put, yes, the syncopation. Because some people will say, Africans brought over syncopation. That's not true. They don't know their history. The reality is syncopation was alive and well here in America before. But the problem is when we took the tribal rhythms and we combined them with other types of our syncopation that was more palatable to a wider audience, boom, we had some serious problems being brewed. In fact, this just laid the groundwork for the 30s, 40s, and eventually into the age of rock and roll, the 50s. Thomas Edison invented sound recording in 1877, and this would drastically change the way that we listened to music. Up to this point, you had to be where the music was being played. Can you imagine a day and age to where you had to be where the people playing the instruments were? Think about that. And then Thomas Edison invents sound recording, and now if you had this little device, you could actually have it in your home or business or wherever you were, and you could have this little tube thing, and you could slide it in there, and it would play what someone else had recorded, maybe all the way around on the other side of the world. Brand new technology. It changed everything. And of course, God used it, and of course, the devil used it. Because if it's efficient at spreading a message, both sides should use it. 20th century. Now, you have to understand, from about 1877 and on, and really about the beginning of the 1900s, music began to explode, and it was very regionalized at that point. It only when you would take and people would travel by ship to different parts of the world was music being shared. Now, recording devices could do it with just sending them through the post or over on a ship. Didn't need to send the musicians. So from about the 1900s on, the music explosion began. In the 20th century, from 1900 to 2000s, artists started using technology to enhance their compositions. Modern popular music was just coming to life, especially in America. We come to this man, Aleister Crowley. Aleister Crowley, why are we talking about him? Well, he will be one of the threads through a lot of the music we're going to listen to in the next 3 hours. He founded the religious philosophy of Thelema. He wrote the Book of the Law, and it states in there, "Do what thou wilt shall be the whole of the law." Crowley claims that the author of this book was an entity named Wyeth, whom later he referred to as his personal holy guardian or his higher self. And it's interesting, all these terms, the higher self and all these energies and all this kind of, it's actually all occult based. It's amazing how much has permeated our society. Aleister Crowley included in his book ideas from the occult, yoga, East and Western mysticism, especially Kabbalah. He expressed views about sex that were absolutely radical. I used to have it in here for his time. No, they're radical even for today. Stuff that's so inappropriate, I'm not even going to mention it. He stated that, quote, he was in revolt against the moral and religious values of his time. Here's what you need to understand. Aleister Crowley is one of the greatest heroes of many, many musicians and entertainers on this planet. They love this man. They worship this man because they believe in the do what thou wilt philosophy, not what God says. God says, no, don't do what you want to do because usually that gets you in trouble. It's my will that will steer you carefully. Amen? Because we should say, nevertheless, not my will, Father, but yours be done. And so this whole thread of do what thou wilt is permeated in our culture, and not only the American culture, but around the world, because we are experts in exporting things of sin. He's also considered the father of modern-day Satanism. He was denounced by the popular press of his day as the wickedest man in the world. Do you know what his own mother called him? The beast. His own mother called him the beast. He desired to use music to bring on the new age. He desired to use, quote, an army of youth, a direct quote out of his book, to indoctrinate with do what thou wilt. Is there not supposed to be God's army of youth out there doing the works of righteousness for him? Yes, but you have to understand that the devil has his disciples too, and they're well funded. Crowley taught that one could become a genius in music through practicing his Satanism, and he's remained an influential figure to current day. Robert Johnson believed in Crowley's "I could become a genius through music" concept. He's often considered the first bluesman in the chain that ultimately led to rock and roll. He experienced what Crowley said in his life. Many of his songs refer to his personal deal that he made with the devil. In fact, what's interesting is when he started, he could barely even play the guitar. And he would go and hang out with some of these old cats that would hang out, and they would play this amazing kind of blues. It wasn't even quite blues. It was more of a ragtime type of song. And blues was just starting to develop, and he couldn't play. And they'd chase him out of the clubs and say, "Get out of here." And he'd go pick up their guitars and start playing, and the guy just wasn't good at it. He took off, was gone for about 9 months. He went down and made a deal with the devil. He came back within 9 months and started to revolutionize the music industry. The devil can be efficient too. And this is one of his songs. "Me and the devil walking side by side.
Me and the devil was walking side by side."
You hear that? Do, do, do.
"Me and the devil."
This laid the basis for the 40s and the 50s right here. In fact, Johnson wrote, "Everyone knows that you make a deal with the devil down at the crossroads." He literally sold his soul to the devil for success. In fact, you can go there to where he's at, where he made his deal. That's Highway 61 and 49. And you can go there, and there's a memorial there that actually indicates there he is with his guitar. And it's actually, there's a little sign right underneath there, and it says there's the crossroads. Pretty amazing what we actually pay homage to in this country. Friends and colleagues share that for the balance of his life, he was a tormented soul. The blues music that came out of Congo Square glorified drinking, womanizing, gambling, drugs, violence, and depravity. Ministers and pastors warned their congregants not to listen to it, and many, praise God, heeded the warning. Even some bluesmen were convinced. Legendary blues picker Gary Davis refused to play the blues after he was ordained as a pastor. The blues was looked upon as the devil's music. Robert Johnson said, referring to the blues, "This sound, my music, did something to women that caused them to do stuff I didn't even understand, but I liked it." The 20th century was responsible for a lot of changes. The amorphous black folk music of the South was shaping up into some of the great musical styles of the 20th century, blues and jazz. So we're going to listen to quite a few clips right now to cover early 1900s to the 1940s to show the progression actually happening. So this first clip would be just basically a raw black folk music. And then this will show some of the progression. Just listen to the different elements, though. Kind of a bad recording. You got different elements happening here, and you've got these. So you have black folk music. You have some American music, and now we get into this third clip around the 1920s, and we have the birth of jazz beginning.
"Oh, I don't want to marry, no way. Now what?
Here, the lower tribal elements are starting to come in. You hear that? Do you hear it down in there? It's a little bit difficult to hear because you have to understand, there's a real recordings, by the way, in 1920. So we went and did a lot of research and found actual recordings. And the fidelity of the recordings back then, you don't get like today. It's like boom, boom. It's amazing what we can do with the technology we have. So some of it is a little more hard to perceive unless you had on earphones and you can really hear what's going on. Clip number four is R&B in the 1930s. That would be rhythm and blues. Listen to the progression. sudden you start to feel all this different kind of grooving going on because you're starting to get this bass rhythm, the polyrhythmic element going with this a new jazz style that's starting to develop, and people were starting to go nuts over it. In fact, it was largely black music at that time, and some of the whites were a little hesitant to start listening to it, but some were like, man, I really like that. That's really soulful, and that's great, and they liked this. And it wasn't until Irving Berlin actually jumped into the scene, and what we would call the lively Tin Pan Alley tradition of white pop began to develop by Irving Berlin. So he took what he was hearing, and he kind of changed it in a way that made it more, quote-unquote, acceptable for the whites. But now we got big band merging with the rhythm and blues. It doesn't make you want to go crazy down here, more like, you know, or whatever. But listen to the, you got to hear the metamorphosis. It's starting to happen, and this is what was going on in America during this time. In 1940, this is what the sound of rhythm and blues had come to. American popular music began to be spread abroad now.
Hey, girl, don't you remember me?
More bass
Forget
elements.
Think about your future. Think about your used to be.
You see the transformation starting now? So it starts to get this transformation going, and it started to become very palatable to a very wide audience. And now here are a few examples of top gospel songs, one from the 20s, one from the 30s, and one from the 40s.
Oh, I'm gonna take a trip in the old gospel ship. I'm going far beyond the sky. Oh, I'm gonna shout and sing until all the heavens ring.
1930s. Okay, so now let's go to 1940s. Now this is gospel music of the time. This one's called Jesus Met the Woman at the Well. This is Jesus talking. It's gospel jazz, and it makes you kind of want to get low as opposed to lifting and ennobling.
Woman,
this is Jesus, by the way.
I want to know, where is your husband at? Oh, woman. I said, woman.
Right? Do you sense the difference right there? It's like, boom, you start adding that, bow, wama, bow, batten, wama. You get this like thing going. In 1947, Crowley dies, but his Satanism lives on and becomes immortalized. His satanic philosophy of do what thou wilt, combined with the accentuated driving beats of the new music, wreaks havoc on the morals of America and the world. And then the 1950s happen. In the 1950s, when we think of that, the first thing that comes to mind is rock and roll. Developed from Southern blues with an added strong backbeat. And in 1951, in an effort to introduce rhythm and blues to a broader white audience, who were still hesitant to fully embrace the black music, disc jockey Alan Freed used the term rock and roll to describe rhythm and blues. Do you know where rock and roll gets its name from, by the way? It actually gets its name from what the young people would do in the backseat of their parents' car while listening to this music, and their gonadotropins were being released, that's the sex hormones, and they would cause the car to start shaking back and forth because of what they were doing in the car. Rock and roll was born from this inappropriate event. Bill Haley in the comments. In 1954, they began to write hit songs. And as a white band, this is brand new breaking ground, as a white band using black-derived forms, they ventured into rock and roll. Rhythm guitar became a key element in the music. And so guitar can be played as a rhythmic element as well. Remember the polyrhythmic elements. It's happier, it's kind of fun, it was kind of energetic, but it was inappropriate.
1, 2, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, rock. 5, 6, 7 o'clock,
polyrhythmic,
8 o'clock,
coming
rock.
Up.
9, 10, 11
syncopation.
O'clock, 12 o'clock, rock. We're going to rock around the clock tonight. Put your bad bags on. Join me home. We'll have some fun when the clock strikes. We're going to rock around the clock tonight. We're going to rock, rock, rock. Rock
so, this
rock,
new music starts to develop within the American culture. And so what we do is we take this new sound now, and it's no longer black, it's no longer white, it's just this new, exciting rock and roll. And everybody is diving in because it is something very, very exciting. Little Richard, have you ever heard of him? Little Richard said this. In fact, he's one of the earliest pioneers of rock and roll. In fact, he is more of the father of rock and roll than Elvis himself. My true belief about rock and roll is this. I believe this kind of music is demonic. A lot of the beats in music today are taken from voodoo, from the voodoo drums. If you study music like in rhythms like I have, you will see that this is true. In fact, in a sermon on music, we heard a story of a young man who came over from Africa and attended college here in America. Not long after being here, he heard a song on the radio and went, "Hey, I know that rhythm. That's from back home. I can play that." So we went and joined the college band. The gentleman who was telling the story told us that the name of the song, "Teardrops from My Eyes." Well, we wanted to hear and know what was it that he heard that made him think of his tribal music back home. Would you like to hear what he heard?
So baby, won't you hurry, because I miss you so, and it's raining, teardrops from my eyes.
He hears this on the radio. He's like, "No, I know that music. That's from back home, because he used to play it there." See, it doesn't have to be this crazy, insane, all of a sudden, prefrontal cortex is inhibited. No, friends. The reality is, it can be so subtle, but if it has those polyrhythmic elements and the wrong syncopated beats, it becomes a physiological, neurological problem for the human instrument. Did you get that? We got to be careful. Oh, we got to be careful. In a VH1 rockumentary, here's what they said. It was through the innocent looks of Bill Haley that rock music was able to slip through the parental radar like a Trojan horse. Well, the gates had been opened, and rock was popular with teens wanting to break out of the conservative American mold. Well, by the late 50s, though, rock and roll began showing its negative effects, and it was unmasked as decadent, dangerous, immoral, and obscene. And there was good reason for people to be concerned. The music had a licentious effect. All of a sudden, young girl and young boy didn't want to listen to mom and dad anymore, to a degree that this planet had never seen before, especially in America. Because what happens now is you're listening to this, you're being programmed, prefrontal cortex is being short-circuited, your frontal moral lobe is being, your filter is no longer engaged there, and so you start accepting all of this music and this licentious effect. You like the way those hormones feel, you like that morphine hit, you like the lyrical content because it's saying, yeah, you can go do whatever you want to do, because it's the philosophy of Aleister Crowley under a lot of it. Very, very crazy if you ask me. Memphis Beat. The author talks of a part of Memphis that was involved in morality, Mill Street. This is where the houses of prostitution, the taverns, and the gambling places were. He states that there was always a certain type of music at Mill Street. This is what he says. The forbidden pleasures of Mill Street always, always came wrapped in the pulsing rhythms of the blues. Have you ever been, well, don't raise your hand. Perhaps you've been to a nightclub. How many nightclubs have you ever been to where they play Mozart? What are you laughing about? Isn't that legitimate music? Sure. But it's funny because in the nightclubs, you would never hear Mozart because it doesn't elicit the right physical, biological, and emotional responses, you see. There's always a certain kind of music in those places that helps them to sell alcohol, which, by the way, messes up the frontal lobe. Sometimes you're doing drugs and you're listening to the music and you wonder why, gee, I made a bad mistake last night. Who are you, by the way, the next morning? Because the prefrontal cortex was gone. You didn't make moral decisions. You made emotionally charged decisions. The limbic system, if you will, took over. B.B. King, he says that women reacted with their bodies flowing to the rhythm coming out of my guitar. He wasn't singing, he was playing, and these women would just fall at his feet. And here's what he played. What's this imitating? It's very sensual and sexual. Dancing with your girl. Right? That's exactly what that's for. Is it not? Of course that's what it is. And then this guy rolled into town. Elvis Presley became the leading figure in the new loved sound of rock and roll. You have to understand, this was still a very new sound. He became the leading figure, and his suggestive stage antics made him enormously popular and controversial. He brought together country, pop, and rhythm and blues in a way that had not been done before. So he has country, pop, and rhythm and blues, and people went ballistic over it. At Elvis's live shows, the influence on the audience became increasingly fevered. Reports said that he'd start out, "You ain't nothing but a hound dog," and they'd go to pieces. Polyrhythmic element. Right? So this is now the full blending of the two. And from here on out, it just spins out of control. Report said he'd start out, "You ain't nothing but a hound dog." They'd go to pieces. They'd always react the same way. There'd be a riot every time. You didn't hear that reporting before, because the fact is, well, you would if you lived back that time, you would see the newspaper reports. And the fact is that many times there would be, not many times, it says every time there would be, that's a direct quote, there would be riots. Why? Well, you had just gotten engaged in this prefrontal cortex removal music, and now all of a sudden you're not in control anymore. Someone gets in your way, like, "Hey, what are you doing? Hey, what?" And everybody's, blah, blah, blah. Make sense? Sure. Logical. More than anyone else, Elvis gave the young a belief in themselves as a distinct and somehow unified generation, the first in America ever to feel the power of an integrated youth culture. What began happening was this insidious, deep-seated do-what-thou-wilt philosophy in the music. It was talking about do whatever you want to do even though mom says no. Do what thou wilt even though the church says no and the pastor says no. Do what thou wilt even though God says no. Even though society says, just be a rebel. I'm just a rebel. That's all I am. Right? And these kids are going, "Yeah, I want to be a rebel too. Ha ha ha. This is new. This is exciting." And the youth unified in this belief that they could just do what thou wilt. It wasn't a good unification of the youth. It was on the wrong platform of self, of engaging in premarital sex and drinking and smoking. And it became cool to smoke that cigarette, even though your parents would say, "Don't do that." And you'd roll it up even to show that you were smoking. Slick your hair back. You were the greaser, right? Rebellion. Wear the black leather jacket. Some of you might have even done that. I don't know. And then the 1960s began. The movement away from the conservative state of America continued. Drugs became a major part of white suburban life for the very first time. The drug experience, coupled with a new political awareness, helped create an underground youth movement. And this became known as the counterculture, which is a group opposing the social mainstream of the day. So in the 60s now, there's this whole idea of, oh, peace and love, and all this stuff starts to brew, and this whole idea of do what thou wilt, you don't even need the government, you don't need anybody. I mean, I'm not saying we need the government, but you get the idea. But this is what was being permeated into the thought processes of the young people. Youth were now turning their thoughts more away from Jesus and opened themselves up to other Eastern spiritualistic ideas. Others opened up toward New Age ideas like astrology and ESP, and ultimately Satanism was on the rise. Aleister Crowley, in addition to being the father of modern-day Satanism, he was into shamanism, which is an Eastern mysticism that comprises a huge range of beliefs and practices concerned with communication with the spirit worlds. Remember, he wanted an army of youth engaged in this conversion process to bring on the New Age. Rock and roll, for all intents and purposes, was gone, but it was short-lived. Also, Crowley was thought of as the father of the hippie counterculture movement, as I said, and he was considered the unsung hero of the 1960s. He was deep into shamanism. Now, he taught that in his satanic doctrine of do what thou wilt, that it should be cloaked under the lie of love. So what's funny is you'd have all these demonstrations and all the stuff that was happening under the guise of love and peace and unity and harmony and all this kind of stuff toward the latter part of the 60s. And he believed that the youth would not understand, but they would fall for it, that they were actually promulgating this do what thou wilt philosophy, where they were actually going against the authorities, the church, the government, their parents, everybody, but yet it was this whole movement of love. Very crazy. And what's amazing is almost every time there would be riots and buildings on fire after these love movements. He believed the youth would fall for it. And like I said, that rock and roll was starting to actually die out. I don't know if you knew that or not, but it was kind of dying out because Elvis got drafted and others died. And before you know it, these big guys were no longer doing the music like they used to. Until these guys rolled into town, the Beatles. One of the most successful acts in history emerged as Beatlemania fad. They quickly transformed, though, and became to be perceived as the embodiment of progressive ideals. The Beatles, and seemingly worse, the Rolling Stones, really took over during this time. And the Beatles started out with music like this. It's not appropriate, but it's really different than where they ended up. And it started out quite simple, and it was talking about things like, I want to hold your hand. Anybody ever heard that little ditty? It still had the polyrhythmic elements. It was still built on an inappropriate platform. I mean, it's fun, it's harmless, right? Well, that's what they want you to think. You see, here's what the devil does. The devil always serves up a couple of options. He's got kind of a buffet. And so he says, look, surely the Rolling Stones were evil, but you could listen to the Beatles. There's nothing wrong with the Beatles, right? Right. So that's what he does. Their influence extended into the social and cultural revolutions of the day. The rebellion against establishments and authority, especially Christians, was of enormous influence. The drug revolution, the sexual revolution, and the synthesis of Western occultism and Eastern mysticism began to take place. The Beatles pushed the counterculture philosophies upon the young people, and the young people fell for it. In fact, what they didn't realize was that they were embracing Aleister Crowley's philosophies. Do what thou wilt. We'll decide what goes on. We'll decide what we do. We'll decide what we smoke, what we listen to. We'll decide how we dress, how we talk, how we act, where we go. And do what thou wilt became, do your own thing. And young people were just imbued with this idea of just do whatever you want to do. Do your own thing. It flies in the face of what God is trying to teach his children. Because doing our own thing usually gets us into a lot of trouble. So do what thou wilt permeated this area of history. Sergeant Pepper's Lonely Heart Club Band. There's a collage on the cover of their best loved heroes. Included among the faces was Aleister Crowley. See that little square up there? Up there in the top left-hand corner? Well, that's none other than Aleister Crowley himself. They only put their heroes on their cover. In fact, they wanted Hitler on there, and if we saw a documentary where there were photos where Hitler, those are all cardboard cutouts, by the way, and except for the Beatles that were in the center. And there's Hitler standing over there off to the side, and the producers came in and said, you probably don't want to have that. You're not going to have greatest album sales if you put that on there. So they go, all right. So they took it off. But Crowley and many others stayed. Only their hero. Why in the world did the Beatles have Hitler as one of their heroes? I don't know. But it doesn't mean they were getting a lot of inspiration from the right places. In the book, The Beatles in Their Generation, it cites this. This is John Lennon saying this. Christianity will go. It will shrink. It will vanish. I will be proved right. You just wait. We are more powerful now than Jesus ever was. Their press secretary, Derek Taylor, said this. The Beatles are completely antichrist. I mean, I'm antichrist as well. But they are so antichrist, they shock me, which is not an easy thing. Music was able to fly under the radar and change the thinking of the world. It was through the influence of the Beatles that millions of youth around the world were almost overnight turned away from Christ to the gurus of the East. In the late 60s and early 70s, Guru Maharishi Mahesh Yogi achieved fame as a guru to the Beatles. He toured with them and was given time during their concerts to indoctrinate. So you have to understand that these musicians and these people, they have a message that they're trying to push. They're not just out there making music for fun. I am a Christian musician, and I have a message that I want to get out there as well. Amen? We're not doing it just to go, oh, I hope this is a fun little song. We have philosophies, and when someone is imbued with a certain philosophy, they will create music that reflects that philosophy. And so their whole philosophy was, do your own thing. Do whatever you want to do. And so what they would do is they would bring this Maharishi with them, and he would sit there at their concerts and was given time to have his sermons while these people are out there smoking dope, bye-bye prefrontal cortex, receiving this information, not critically analyzing and rejecting it, thereby being changed by the words and music they heard at the concerts. Oh, but it's just music. It was reported that millions of people began to study the teachings of the Maharishi. Before the Beatles, Indian spirituality was not an everyday part of our Western culture. Through the hippies following the Beatles, yoga and meditation became a new fad. It became cool, man, to do this and to do that. Now we have yoga on every corner. There was never anything like this until they came along. Yoga is actually a word that means to yoke and speaks of yoking with pagan gods. What's interesting to me is that many of the baby boomers, many of those that were raised in the 50s and 60s and 70s, and they were this youth, a part of this time, they were so duped and tricked into thinking that they were actually just doing their own thing. They were actually being free to do whatever, and yet they were following the devil and Aleister Crowley's teaching and didn't even know it. They were conforming to the church, if you will, because they all dressed the same. They all smoked the same dope. They listened to the same Beatles. Yet they were their own person. No, they weren't. And I hear the same thing today. Why are you down on my music, man? Why are you down on my pants that hang way down here and I can't even hold them up and I walk around like a weird guy? Because I got to hold them up, right? Yo, what's up? I talked to this one guy and he said, I said, hey, brother. I said, what's up with your pants there? He goes, what? I said, what's up with your pants? I said, pull them up, man. Is your dad overweight and you had to borrow his? What's the deal? He's like, man, well, and I had created a little bit of a relationship with this young man during a week of prayer. And so he's sitting there walking around like this because there's no staff around, and I caught him. He's walking around like that with his hat all, you know, and he's doing this thing. And I said, brother, why are you dressed like that? Can I just ask you? And he says, what? I'm just being my own man. I said, no, you're not. Yes, I am. No, you're not being your own man. You're dressing like every other fool out there. And he goes, word. And he walked off. I mean, made him think for a moment. You're just conforming to a style, but the lie is this. You're just being your own person as long as you look like us. Right? It's just so ridiculous. But the youth fall for it, and Aleister Crowley knew they would. Lennon shared of his experience. He said, I felt like a hollow temple filled with many spirits, each passing through me, each inhabiting me for a little time, and then leaving to be replaced by another. Yucky. Amen? He's talking about possession here. Talking on the writing of his songs, he says, I don't know who the bleep wrote it. I'm just sitting and the whole bleeping thing comes out. They're getting these songs from the devil himself. Later he said, I've sold my soul to the devil. In another interview later in his life, Lennon said, the whole Beatle idea was to do what you want, right? Do what thou wilt. There's a direct quote from the leader of the band. Timothy Leary, a Harvard professor and Crowley follower, referred to the Beatles as the four evangelists and stated that rock music was as much as a deconditioner as psychedelic drugs. It is designed to blow your mind and suspend your conditioned reflexes. Listening to a Beatles album is an hour of deconditioning. Whoa! It's even more powerful if you know who Timothy Leary is and what he did, a professor at Harvard. He actually would experiment with LSD, I'm a techie guy, I'm sorry, with LSD. He actually did all these experiments that were paid for by the university and grants. He did all these experiments with LSD and psychotropic drugs. He was an expert in the field, a user as well, but he was an expert in his field. And they would do all these tests because it was this new drug around, and they're thinking, wow, what does this do to people? And so they'd do all their scientific experiment, and they're like, wow, this is really blowing people's mind. So for him to sit here, and by the way, he's a Crowley follower, accepting this whole satanic message of do what thou wilt and embracing the occultic themes in the world. So let's reread what he said. He said, referring to the Beatles as the four evangelists, he said that rock music was as much a deconditioner as psychedelic drugs. He was an expert in psychedelic drugs. It is designed to blow your mind. Would anybody disagree that psychedelic drugs blow your mind? Guess what part of the mind it does affect? The frontal lobe, prefrontal cortex. Huh, are we putting two and two together yet? So now he says, wait a second. It's designed, he says, rock and roll is just as much of a deconditioner and affects the brain as psychedelic drugs. It's designed to blow your mind and to suspend your conditioned reflexes. So in other words, the devil loves you. No, it doesn't, because I have my prefrontal cortex intact, and it says, I reject that. That is a falsehood. That is a lie. But I listen to the wrong stuff, and the devil loves you. I'm like, oh, okay. Hello? This is how it works. Listening to the Beatles, a Beatles album, is an hour of deconditioning. Yet it's sold under the lie that you're free to do whatever you want. You're your own man. No, you're not. You're just becoming a drone like everybody else. It's when you become a Christian and have your eyes opened and you see these things that you are free indeed. Oh, I wish I would have seen this when I was a lot younger. Something else that Professor Leary said that was very interesting. Don't listen to the words. It's the music that has its own message. Couldn't have said it better myself. And then from I Want to Hold Your Hand, the Beatles move into this psychedelic stuff.
You
That's pure voodoo right there. Juju eyeballs, holy roller, all this. I mean, it's amazing. Their music started to really reflect their lifestyle. And at the same time, the Beatles, the Rolling Stones, came into town. And they emerged as the anti-Beatles because the good guys were listening to the Beatles. The good kids were listening to the Beatles. And those who were like that were really in revolt and rebellion, they were listening to the Rolling Stones, you see. That's how it goes. The devil serves up two platters. Surely you don't want to listen to the Rolling Stones, but you could listen to the Beatles. The reality is, the Beatles and the Rolling Stones were actually signed by the same company. They had the same people working for them. And they thought, wow, we can get those who want this hardcore stuff and those who want, I want to hold your hand. We can get them both. We can make money on both ends. And while the satanic ideologies were more hidden within the music, the Stones' stand was, well, not really hard to figure out. In fact, they had an album called Sympathy for the Devil. Does the devil need sympathy? No, he made his decision, and I don't feel sorry for him. One of their most provocative songs ever. Sympathy for the Devil. Listen to that booty. Listen to that. That's straight out of Africa.
Please allow me to introduce myself. I'm a man of wealth and taste. I've been around for a long, long year. Stole many a man.
By the way, this is Lucifer singing to you. Listen.
I was around when Jesus Christ had his moment of doubt and pain. Made damn sure the pilot washed his hands and sealed his face. Pleased to meet you. Hope you guessed my name.
The whole song goes on and tells all these things that he does. We're at the end anyway. So what I want you to consider is this. The devil is doing his best to deceive us into believing we can just do what we want to do. Can we do that? We actually have the free will to do whatever we want. That's the reality. But friends, the moment we become a Christian and we take the name of Christ into our life, we now are beholden to a glorious God that knows what's better for us. Amen? And so at that point, I no longer engage in the things perhaps that I used to if they were inappropriate. The things that are appropriate and I don't have to do away with, then God says you can retain it. But those things that will hinder our connection, distract us from our Maker, those things that do that, the Lord knows they need to be out of our lives. And this philosophy of do what thou wilt, just do your own thing, it continues to be morphed throughout the ages. And all the way up to 2011, you will see the same thread as we continue our music history in the subsequent messages. Let's have a word of prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you for allowing us to hear these things. I pray that you would help us to hear where music began, that beautiful music, and how it's been amalgamated and twisted over the years to serve carnal purposes, low purposes. Lord, I pray that you would help us to make sure that we are listening to and engaging in things that only please you, because you know what's best for us. And we want to come and be with you soon in those pearly gates. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for sharing these things with us, even though they're hard to swallow sometimes. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, and may your names remain in the book of life.